We're in Ezra, 1 Corinthians 2, and Luke 1, and Luke 2. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Father, we come in Jesus' name and we thank you for your word. Thank you for the promise that where two or more are gathered in your name, you'll be in our midst. And we ask for us that you might bless us with your presence, especially in our inner man, that your name would be magnified in our midst as we lift you up. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Well, we're in the Gospel of Luke, and we're doing this orderly account where we're also paying attention to the reading of the Word and the doctrine or the teaching that's in the Word, the exhortation that comes to us, and we're to be meditating, giving ourselves wholly to these things. Yay, we're finished with chapter 1 and we're in chapter 2, finally, after 6 weeks, or 7, I forget. And I've titled today, I don't think we're going to be quite as long in this section, but I've titled the section today, Door to Providence, or Walking in the Spirit in Ordinary and Unexpected Situations. Children, this will be a especially beneficial message for you as you realize there's a lot of hard things in life to do, a lot of mundane chores and things that are wearisome. And when we go through the chapter 2 today, we're going to discover that because people were doing the mundane things, or at least because they were doing the things that were hard that they had to do, they were in the right place and they met God in special ways because of that. I was thinking of a children's story that could be written from chapter 2. Did you ever see the movie The Fourth Wise Man? Yeah, that's an old classic. But I was thinking a story of a shepherd boy who missed out on seeing Jesus because he was too lazy to get out of bed and go watch the sheep. And he missed out because he wasn't there. But anyway, we're not going to focus on lazy boys. It's not the plan this morning. So Joel was wondering why I chose to open with Ezra chapter 9. And I was reading Ezra chapter 9, and it just sort of touched that spot in my spirit where there's an aching going on. Most of us have heard the news accounts of Planned Parenthood, and most of us don't quite get it that 43 years abortion has been raging in our country. 43 years, and there's but the numbers of abortions are down, but still we're over 300,000 a year in our country. And when you're living in a culture and there's just this constant flow of wickedness and sin, our frailty, the weakness that we have of who we are, is so significant that eventually we just become numb to these things. And as I was reading the account of Ezra, it struck me that he was sensitized to spiritual truth as it needed to be applied to God's people, while he was saturated in a culture that had no interest in God. And that sensitivity to God is what's so important, that we care for, that we practice, that we learn from. So what I'm not going to go into the book of Ezra today, but I would like to make a suggestion in terms of our opening meditation, and that is when we are focused properly on the nature of right and wrong. But what I sensed was with Ezra, he recognized where the emphasis was for God's people. And if you finish reading that account later, you'll discover that chapter 10 opens with of repentance breaking out among the people as they recognize their own sin. This is God's people, and they're confessing their sin and turning from it and putting away the wickedness and the defilement that they had already taken upon themselves in the new land. So it's the transition, Joel, just because I know you want to make sure you have a proper transition. So the transition is, it's really difficult to be sensitive spiritually in a culture that's totally insensitive. And that's the culture we live in America today. And sadly, it saturates God's people significantly as well because of so many elements and so many ways that we can participate in that culture and become numb to it. So my admonition, my encouragement as we go through the message today is to be able to ask and answer the question, how can I be sensitive? Me, personally. How can I pay attention to those things that make me sensitive in the heart of the Lord? Well, came across a verse this week from Proverbs 20:27, and I apologize for the crowdedness of the title there. It should be more space between the verse and the title. But the title is, "The Spirit of Man is the Candle of the Lord," and the proverb says that this candle of the Lord is searching the inward parts of the belly. That's King James, inward parts of man. And it's something to think about. So I want to make a couple observations at the start here, and then we're going to just discuss a little bit. The subtitle, if you remember, is Walking in the Spirit in Ordinary and Unexpected Situations. What makes us different from animals? God put a portion of His Spirit in us, and we're made in the image of God. And the profoundness of us being made in the image of God is so significant that God has put a ban on man ever interfering with the life of another human being. The specialness of who we are being made in the image of God outpaces every other perspective that we might have. And so there's this universal ban that basically says, I don't have the right as a human to look at your life as a human and value it as I see fit. I'm not capable of valuing your life as I ought. Only God can value our lives and give our lives that kind of value, and our lives are valuable because they're sharing a portion of the eternal God in that creation. So we had an interesting talk around the family table about this, and at first it just seems like a clumsy verse that don't spend a lot of time thinking about. But as we talked about it, I realized, you know, it's really significant. Today when we go into Luke 2, we're going to see this candle of the Lord at work in people's lives. And my challenge to you personally this morning is the candle burning in you. I was threatening to sing the song of Chris Rice. There's a candle. Some of you might know that song. Go light your world. But he basically says there's a candle burning in every soul. And it's a candle that's there by the Lord to be lit by the Lord. Anyway, I thought the song was appropriate. So I want to make a statement to you and I. So today, if I walk just as a man, so I'm walking by my natural being, I guess I should stay at the microphone since we're trying to record. If I'm walking as just a man, in the natural man, in the flesh, I'm walking without the fullness of who I might be, because God has created me to be walking in the Spirit, whereby my spirit is connected to the Spirit of God. And so one of my all-time favorite passages is in 2 Corinthians chapter 2. I know we've, excuse me, 1 Corinthians chapter 2. I know we've done this chapter frequently in recent years, but go ahead and turn your Bible there if you wish. I have it on the screen. Paul is speaking, beginning in the first verse here of chapter 2. And I, brethren, when I came to you, I came not with excellency of speech or wisdom, declaring to you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Now, meditating on that passage after studying Luke 2 was quite incredible, of an eye-opening picture. Let's look at a couple of the key words here that are really significant. Paul said, when I came unto you, I didn't come in excellency of speech or wisdom. Now, you and I might not realize this, but the wisdom of the Greeks at the time that Paul is writing this was huge. All of the educational systems that existed sprang from the whole intellectual structure that was set forth by the Greeks. Not saying that some of that intellectual process was not sometimes used. It seems like Paul was raised in some of that wisdom, and God used him in writing the epistles to be able to clarify the word in significant ways. But I didn't realize just how incredible this wisdom was back then in that world, and I guess it still is today in some circles. But my Blue Letter Bible online study that I primarily use often has words that some guy by the name of Trent used for comparing synonyms. And so if you see one of the words that he has, Trent synonyms, you know, click on it, and it's really intellectually done. It's like kind of like over my head most of the time. The part that's the most difficult is when he's talking, if he's quoting somebody in Hebrew, he just quotes the Hebrew, or he just quotes the German, or he doesn't ever bother translating. So it's really difficult to try to, well what was he saying? So he said, I really like what so-and-so said, and then he writes verbatim what the German guy said, and I have no clue what the guy said. But anyway, but he does all this comparative, and what he does, in order to help us get the understanding of what words mean, some words are pretty significant, he'll take the usage of those words, and how it might have occurred in ancient Greece and modern Greece and biblical language, and it, sort of just to give a flavor, so we have a reasonable understanding what the words intended to mean. But I don't remember what word it was, but one time I got snagged by one of his little discussions, and I somehow linked up to some group that was discussed, and I somehow got to this link, and there's a live intellectual group that exists today in the world. I guess it's all around. And they spend all of their time intellectually trying to discern what Homer meant in the opening lines of the Iliad. And I'm like, I am overwhelmed. I mean, we're talking about, this discussion has been going on for decades, and they're just trying to understand. And all of a sudden I begin to understand, okay, wisdom of man, I get it. If you can really put your words together and make a convincing argument, and then somebody comes back with their convincing argument. But they're spinning years off their life having a discussion about the opening, I think it's the opening phrase. There's one sentence that, and they were trying to wonder about the significance of it. But in that context, we have to really understand, men love words And men love reasoning by words. And there's a really big issue that we have that we have to recognize, that intellectualism has the ability to make us puffed up in our head, but it doesn't necessarily mean we're going to have truth or that we're going to walk in truth or that we're going to be useful to the Lord. So Paul is stating here, he's declaring the testimony of God, and I want to point out a word. The second verse says, "For I determined not to know anything among you." Bet you can't guess what that word is. It's from the root word from krino, which means to judge. And all the passages in the Bible talk about judging. Judge not lest you be judged, whatever. It's a root word of judgment. And that makes the word more powerful. Determined is a pretty strong word. But when you put it in the context of Paul thoughtfully said, you know what? I'm passing judgment on how I'm going to minister to the body of Christ. I am not going to come to you with the wisdom of men's words. When I come to you, I'm going to preach Christ and Him crucified. That's the outline. That's the focal point. And so, but backing up, declaring unto you the testimony of God. So, I want you to understand, declaring the testimony of God requires some things. Declaring the testimony of God requires some things. Let's look at those. Verse 3, "And I was with you in weakness." We're declaring the testimony of God requires weakness. "And in fear. And in much trembling. Not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but demonstration of the Spirit and of power. That your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God." Now, I don't think you have any idea how huge that is. There's a little barrier, and I got past the barrier finally. What does it mean, demonstration of the Spirit? The signs and wonder folks sometimes really get off on this. And what happens with signs and wonders folks is all of a sudden their identity is wrapped up in they're doing signs and wonders. Now, if you remember from the Gospel of John, when the Holy Spirit was being promised, Jesus said something very substantial about the ministry of the Spirit. He said, the Holy Spirit is not going to speak of Himself, but He's going to speak of Jesus. And so what's often happened in the signs and wonder circles of the Christian experience, we often get so focused on the Spirit and we miss the point. And so when Paul says demonstration of the Spirit, I looked up that word, and you know what the root word is? It's a sign that points, it's kind of like the power of the word, is it pointing away from yourself, pointing to something more significant. And see, that's the critical key, and you can't have that pointing away from yourself very easily unless you're in weakness and in fear and trembling and are people of great need. Now, when we go to chapter 2 of Luke, I want you to just pay attention because that description fits all the people where this incredible demonstration of the Spirit of God occurs as the Savior is born. So we're going to catch that in a little. But I have one more rant back in 1 Corinthians 2, down to verse 16. I want us to understand something. You have no idea how important it is for you to have weakness, to walk in fear and trembling. You have no idea how huge that is to your spiritual vitality. Because that's the mechanism by which you are going to be able to speak authoritatively. And I rather say the way Paul said it, you're going to be able to give a testimony in an authoritative fashion. This is what God has done. And it's going to be so unmistakable, they're going to look at you and say, well, I know it's not you. And that's important. It needs to be that. And the saddest part of the Christian life is that so often people get hung up on looking at other people, and they see some other person who's walking perfectly. That's the outward observation. And it becomes a barrier. I can never do that, because we see our weakness in that person's incredible performance, and we're just shut down. And that's a battle. That performance battle is something we all struggle with. I don't think we'll ever escape it in our entire life in terms of it being a battle we have to deal with. Let's go through it quickly. Howbeit, we speak of wisdom among them that are perfect. Now, what you need to understand the play on words here, not the wisdom of the world, nor the princes of the world that come to nothing, but we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom, which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Think about that for just a quick second. The cross, Christ crucified, is such a distorting message to the wisdom of the world that it's totally unembraceable, totally unacceptable. You can never attract a fleshly motive to the cross, because the cross is the instrument of death to that flesh, to that fleshly motive. So it's impossible. But there's wisdom in it, and the wisdom is found in that poetic manner in which Christ called us to discipleship. If you would lose your life for my sake in the gospel, you'll find it. But if you're going to save your life, then you're going to lose it. So it's that whole underlying element. And so this morning, as we go through, you're probably going to tell me, well, the people we reviewed in chapter 2, it's not that horrible of a situation. I mean, shepherds are shepherds, and people have to travel on occasion. You know, it doesn't look like a horrible situation. But what I'm trying to draw out is that man naturally measures what's right in terms of what's appropriate, what's helpful to man in his natural circumstance. And so what we have in this mystery of the wisdom of God is this. If what you think is really true pleases the flesh, it's not true at all. If the natural man gets all excited about what you're speaking, you're not on the topic of the gospel. When you speak the hidden wisdom of God, it's an offense. Paul went on to say it in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, another favorite chapter of mine. He went on to say in that chapter, he said, "For we, those who are saved, were always led in triumphant procession in Jesus Christ." And I just thought, wait a minute. What do you mean, always led in triumphant procession? Then he goes on and describes triumphantness. There's two groups of people that we always influence in a proper way. So here I am, the slave of Jesus Christ. I'm being paraded by my difficult circumstances as a slave in difficulty and circumstances beyond my control, circumstances that are not gorgeous or beautiful or happy. And here I am being paraded before the world in these horrible circumstances. And Jesus says, I'm always triumphant. Here's how I'm going to always be triumphant. I'm going to manifest the wisdom of God. And he called it the fragrance. And he goes on and he says, well, there's two kinds of fragrance. To those who are being saved, it's a fragrant of life. It's a sweet-smelling savor of life. But to those who are lost, it's the smell of death. So I want you to think about this. I saw a really cool illustration once by some man, I forget his name, who did a little science illustration about vultures. You know what a vulture is? Well, he went biologically into the nature of a vulture and, you know, gave all kinds of scientific facts about him, which was all good. But the part that made everybody so grossed out in the presentation was how he said that they like to eat well-rotting dead things. Now, you and I know what a well-rotting dead thing smells like to us. It's putrid. It's horrible. It makes you want to run the other way. It's so horrible. But he described it in terms of the vulture as this chocolate cake steaming up with the most delicious. And it's like, you know, come on, give me a break. But that's exactly how God's truth gets manifest. You and I have got to be the stench of death to the lost in order for us to be the fragrance of life to those who are believing. We've got to. And that's tough. And when we look backward at that little comment that Jesus said, all of you shall be offended in me this night, that's what gets offended in us. Our flesh hates the smell of death. Jesus was going to the death. That was an offense. We didn't follow Jesus to die. We followed Jesus because we had plans of sitting on the right hand. In fact, we got our mothers to go and, you know, vie for us, get that special seat before somebody else gets it. We're totally incapable. And I want you to know today, you and I are all struggling with that same battle in the flesh. Our flesh hates the stench of death. But that's the crossroads of truth and how truth gets preached and how truth gets manifested. So he goes on and he says this, thinking of that wretched smell of carrion. Eye has not seen, maybe we should say, nose has not smelled, neither has entered into the mouth of man, the things which God has prepared for them that love him. But they are revealed to him by his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God, for what man knows the things of man save the spirit of man which is in him, even so the things of God knows no man but the Spirit of God. So, point of reference. Man was created body, soul, and spirit. But it's our spirit that connects us to our Heavenly Father. It's our spirit whereby we move from just being animal to being something far more than animal, an everlasting, eternal spirit. And though our bodies die and our souls perish, our spirits continue living on after death, immediately, continuously. And so, the spiritual reality that God has for man is this. If you look at life as a natural man, you only measure it by the experiential elements of life as it is known on earth. But if that's all you have, if that's all you live, you're going to be robbed of life, because true life is life in the spirit. That eternal spirit, God, has to share with us in love and relationship. God's a spirit. We must learn to worship in him in spirit and in truth. And so God's calling us to learn to live in the spirit, the outlook of the spirit. And it's that revelation to the spirit where the truth of God gets into our spirit. And all of a sudden, what was once the stench of death to the natural man, while it's still a stench of death to the natural man, suddenly we have the vision of eternity before our eyes, and we see heaven, and we see God's purpose, and we say yes. Remember those little illustrations that Jesus gave when he was talking about the kingdom of God? Matthew 13 has a few of them. And he gives the kingdom of heaven is like. And one of the things that he says it's like is, it's like a man walking in a field. And he finds a treasure. He hides the treasure. And he goes off, and the key word here for the flesh is he sells everything he has. Sells everything he has to buy that field. Now, that probably means he was buying that field above market value because he didn't want anybody else to get it. Now, as a child, I would sit there in church and I would hear the scriptures read where Jesus would say, sell everything you have. And as a child, I would think, what would we do if we sold everything we had? And I just worried like a flesh-based creature. if you get rid of everything that is life in the flesh, you're dead. But the spiritual dynamic, the spiritual reality is, when the spirit man sees more than, it's all of a sudden like Paul says in Philippians chapter 2. The things that I once counted dear to me, I now count but loss. Then he has this really incredible phrase. To me, it's like a wheelbarrow of manure. That's how wonderfully valuable all these things of this world are to me. They're just, now, a wheelbarrow of manure, if you're a farmer, it's valuable for raising the next year's crop. But, you know, most people don't hug their manure. And if they do, nobody will hug them. So, it's an incredible picture that the spirit man sees what the natural man never can see. And it's not until your spirit man can see that you can walk above this world, above the influence of your peers, above the influence of the culture, above the influence of your fears and your worries. You can walk in these things because you have heaven in view. And you're able to say like Paul, well, I'm caught between two opinions. If I should die, wow, that would be so much better. Like, I'd be with Jesus. You know, the natural man doesn't want to hear that. What do you mean? I mean, you know, ask a groom and a bride on their wedding day, hey, how would you like to go to heaven right now? Just skip this whole wedding thing. It'd be very difficult for that human spirit to release that, to be sure. So, what we understand here is that there is secret wisdom. Now, we're not going to start a secret society. I understand there are some out there. I don't remember their names, so I won't bore you with them. But they're in our culture over the years for sure. But when I say secret, here's the secret. They're sitting in plain view, but the natural man has no capacity to see it for what it is. The natural man sees a dead corpse stinking and rotting, and it's not a treasure to him. The fact that it's a treasure is hidden from his view. He just sees the loss of life. Now, I want you to understand something, how important this is in terms of absolute truth. Are you aware that if there is no eternity, then we Christians who are trying to live for a heavenly purpose, we're the most pitiful people on earth? Because we're wasting the only life we have. Paul said that in 1 Corinthians 15. That if there's no heavenly tomorrow, if there's no eternity, if you and I aren't going to transcend this world and go on to the next, if that's not happening, then we're of all men most miserable, and the world's philosophy is correct. Eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. So here's the battle lines. Every person who sold out to natural living has this impeccable understanding of the value of life. I'm going to live my life to the fullest. I'm going to get everything I can. I'm going to get all the gusto. If only going around once in, I've got to grab and get and go. And that's the appropriate outlook on life if all life is an experiential, natural opportunity. Now, we know that doesn't make anybody happy, causes more crime and suicide than anything on earth, but that's the spiritual reality. So the bottom line is, eye has not seen, ear has not heard, okay? The natural man doesn't have the capacity to see the secret wisdom of God. But the Spirit receives it. So it's imperative that you understand one thing. When the Scripture talks about being born again, the Scripture talks about it in terms of the Spirit of the living God. Except a man be born again, he'll never see the kingdom of heaven. See that? Eyes can't be opened to the heavenly. The Spirit of God must enter in. And then, as we saw in Romans 8, the Spirit of God witnesses to our spirit. We're the sons of God. See, that's insight. That's understanding. That's value. beyond what the natural man can perceive. He continues, we've not received the spirit of the world, but the spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God, which things we also speak, not in the words of man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Ghost teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. So it's imperative that we understand something. You know, I'm sure you've heard somebody say in your Christian life, you should read your Bible. How many of you have never heard anybody say, read your Bible? You've all heard it. And this is why. The Word of God, it's living. It's powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword. It's this incredible resource, and the Spirit of God takes that Word of God, and it makes it quick, and it makes it life to us, and all of a sudden, my spirit sees stuff that my natural man can't see. And just like the guy that's willing to go off and sell everything he has to buy that field, I see the treasure, and I'm willing to trade it in. I'm willing to say, you know what? This dung heap of this life is nothing compared to what God has. And so we transition, so we transfer. But you have to understand, the world you live in has to see that in you in order for there to be an authentic testimony about truth. They have to see you living like there is a tomorrow in the face of everybody who's living like there isn't. And that's why they say the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. Because men who love not their life to the death are only capable of that when they see, I have a life that can't be taken from me. I have eternal life, and I can never die. Look at the last paragraph, and I'll go on. The natural man receives not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. That's why it's a secret. You can tell a natural man the truth, and they just look at you with this blank look. Are you kidding me? Is that what I'm supposed to believe? You gotta be. You're crazy. It says, no way the natural man, it is, because the natural man has, when the natural man's listening, they hear, here's one thing, die. Die. Your little kingdom, it's not going to survive, and God's not interested in it surviving as if it's something special in and of itself. They're foolishness to him. Neither can he know them because they're spiritually discerned. But the spiritual judges all things, and yet he himself is judge of no man. For who has known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him, but we have the mind of Christ. So, as we go to Luke, let's go ahead and go to Luke. As we go to Luke chapter 2, I want us to understand there's just a few players here we're going to be going through. In every situation here, we have a natural setting. And in this natural setting, some profound spiritual realities are going to take place. The thing that I want us to remember is weakness, fear, and trembling. That's what we bring to the equation. We don't bring wisdom. We don't bring a strategy. We don't bring how I'm going to get around it so I can save my life. We don't bring that to the table. So before us, we have at least one person who can understand this. So Joel gets a call today, and it's President Barack Hussein Obama saying, Joel, you need to get your wife on her donkey, and you need to take her back to Washington State or Oregon or wherever she's from. We've got to have a little tax out there. And you say, listen, we do any day. Can we file an extension? Nah, sorry. Better get going. Now, Michaela may understand. It may be a little disturbing to her to think that she's got to ride a donkey all the way to Washington, starting today. And she may have the baby along the way, or at least when she gets there. So we have this picture. It came to pass in those days, went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. Now, I love it when you take all the world and yourself. What an interesting comparison. Because I'm only living my life, and so my life is all the world to me. And I'm not capable of interacting, connecting with the whole world. I'm just living my life. And here's where the human spirit has so much tragedy in terms of struggle. I want to preserve my life, and I don't like circumstances that look threatening to that preservation of my life. You get it? I mean, I just have a question. I think I've asked this once before. How many American women would have done this? I don't know. Anyway, so the decree goes forth. Now I want us to understand something. While God is willing to ruin your earthly life, He never ruins it for no cause. He always has a greater heavenly purpose. In fact, I don't know that there'll be enough time in heaven to hear all the stories, the incredible things that God has done as He's worked out His purpose in what was threatening circumstances to men whose life was trying to find purpose just in this world. But culture, government, and necessity, nature, we're all at vying here. I believe the Roman Empire was a terrifying government, and you didn't flippantly ignore that government. It was God's plan that Jesus be born in Bethlehem. He prophesied about it years ago. Jesus will be born in Bethlehem. And as we paid attention to the chapter one of the story, Mary and Joseph didn't happen to be living in Bethlehem. They happened to be living in Nazareth. And they were, I don't know how far away Nazareth is from Bethlehem, but they weren't in Bethlehem. And so, how was God going to move them there? Now, this is a test of your faith I want you to really think about. We just were in chapter one. And we just saw that there's this angel named Gabriel, and he's like standing in the presence of God all the time, and God's working stuff out, and God sent Gabriel down to Zacharias. Okay, go tell Zacharias he's going to have a child. And he didn't, had a hard time believing him. Then he said, now, okay, it's been about 3 months. Go down and talk to Mary. Now, why on earth, when that angel came down to talk to Joseph, which we saw in Matthew chapter 2, why on the earth didn't the angel just say, by the way, Joseph, you happen to be in Nazareth, and the prophets say you have to be in Bethlehem, we need you to move. I mean, the angel easily could have said that. I mean, he was right there talking to Joseph. So this is what you and I have to deal with, because you and I in the flesh, that's how we think. We want it laid out in clear Hebrew or English, exactly what God's plan is, and then we, okay, so that's your plan, fine, God, it's your plan. But we fail to understand that the whole tension between the natural man and the spirit man is crossed over between one little access point, and that's faith. And I learned to trust God, and faith always has to do with fear and trembling and weakness. The only time I ever need faith is in those points. I'm in weakness, fearing for my life, I'm trembling, I don't know what's going to happen, and I have to bring those terrible situations under spiritual arrest, and I have to believe God in those circumstances at that point. And so they did. Now, the Bible doesn't say anything about their conversation. In fact, it doesn't even say they rode on a donkey. That's something that's pictured in our creche scenes, but I don't know. So the baby was born, and she was born in Bethlehem, and more, furthermore, she was born in a stable because there was no room in the inn. She delivered in a stable, excuse me, I'm thinking of Mary. She had her little one in a stable. And I just want us to think about it. Because I've been a pastor now for 38 years, and I'll tell you what, the hardest thing that I have as a pastor is to watch Christians time and time again. They find their earthly circumstance, and they realize that I can take up my cause and save my life. Why shouldn't I? That's unjust. That's unnecessary. And our natural man has no capability whatsoever to truly evaluate the weight of things before the throne of God. So it's always tempted. I was thinking about this, and I remember the children of Israel. So they get out in the wilderness, and, you know, well, actually, they kind of had this repetitious grumbling spirit, and there's 10 major identified grumblings in Book of Numbers. But when Moses first comes around and he goes to Pharaoh, the people all say, "You haven't so much as delivered us. You're just causing more trouble for us." They're grumbling because. So then they get out in the wilderness and they say, "You haven't taken us to any promised land. Well, here we are in the wilderness and we can't even water our flocks." And I just want us to understand that that's how God does it. That's where the secret hidden wisdom is always found. I find myself in weakness and fear and trembling. And there alone, will my test be tried, my faith be tested. And as a believer, by God's grace, I'm going to lay a hold of eternal life. I'm going to trust God. And I'm going to be fine with what the consequences, with what the circumstances. Shepherds. Now, I know you've all heard a lot of things about the shepherds. They were like the dirty, you know, the dirty job, low-class citizens of the time. And the shepherds of Bethlehem were primarily raising sheep for the temple sacrifice. But here they are, faithful. Oh, I forgot to give you my one point. Top of the panel. I have to go back to the title, which says, "The Door to Providence." And so each of these titles, "The Door to Providence" is the door of government edicts, and then the door of mundane duty. Door of mundane duty. Children, you'll have no greater difficulty in childhood than this one issue, dealing with mundane duty. It's so easy to get so exasperated and so worn out. It's so easy to cut corners. So easy to not value it. Why do I have to do this? You ever say that when you're given a chore? Why is it essential? And I just want us to see really quick, clearly, really simply here. These shepherds, low-class people as they were, in the place they ought to be, and in their weakness, in their lowliness, they were in the right place at the right time. And the angel of God visited them. But I just, do you get the picture? Paul said, "I've determined that you're not going to know anything but the power of the Holy Spirit." And I just want to ask you this question. Do you think we'd be impressed with the way Jesus was born if it was managed and controlled by American standards and whimsical emotion? And do you think these shepherds, the visitation of the shepherds, do you think that would be significant to us if it wasn't something that was so obvious? Did these guys conjure up these stories and run around telling them? No. One of the things I wanted to point out when we were looking at the last chapter, towards the end, it's important we recognize what a testimony is, what a testimony does. When I'm in weakness and I tell the story of what God did for me, that testimony ripples through community. How many conversations do you start? Did you hear what happened to... The nature of the human spirit is wired with that sense of worry and wonder when things don't turn out negatively. And so it's imperative that we understand that for God to do something significant, He likes that gap to be there between what the natural can do in its strength and what God is doing in His wisdom. So the door to contemplation, excuse me, the door of contemplation. Now, here's something that I just want to put on you, okay? If you're a human being, if you have the Spirit as God has put in you as a candle, it's impossible for that Spirit to be activated without circumstances that force trauma and without that trauma forcing contemplation. And then after that, there's more contemplation. People don't think. It's an astonishing thing to me how people don't think. It's an astonishing thing to me how, as Christianity spreads, every generation has to struggle with this. There's a little revival and many people get saved, and all of a sudden there's this gigantic problem among these so-called believers, because so many of them are just following other believers and trying to make sure that they're fitting in like they ought to be, and none of them have learned the spiritual dynamic, the spiritual art of contemplation. I am made in God's image. He caused a portion of His Spirit to be in me. Furthermore, He's caused there to be tension in my natural man so that my spirit man feels that tension and looks for a Savior. Then in His glorious plan, He redeems me. And in my spirit man, He brings the Holy Spirit. But brothers and sisters, the Christian life can only be a life of contemplation. I have to be thinking about what's going on. Now, you might say, well, I thought we had to, you know, have a quick response and be ready to, you know, to do what, but that's true, but you don't get that to that place of a quick response without having taken deliberate time. Yeah, Daniel and his brethren, when they were faced with a circumstance, they had a quick response and they asked for an alternative. But the point was, the contemplation had already taken place. They had already purposed by contemplation, purposed in their heart not to defile themselves. And so it's so imperative. Why do you do what you do as a Christian? Why do you do it? Maybe the first question I'd ask is, what do you do? Do you do anything as a Christian that's Christian? It's so easy, children, to be raised in a Christian home and just to follow along whatever is done in your home because your parents love the Lord and they're trying to raise you up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, and you just do what they do. But the dynamic of that candle of the Spirit that God's put in us, that is so important, so powerful, because what God wants and what God can do is that with His Spirit resting upon my spirit that He put in me, which is a portion of His Spirit, with that activity going on, as I think about things and I settle out and understand what really matters by the Spirit of God, I can rise up and do what's right no matter what the cost. And I'm not afraid of death because I see that this is just a temporary passing and all of eternity is before me. So just a couple things, and this is just right out of the Luke passage here, verses 17 to 20. When they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying, told them concerning this child. And all that heard wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for the things they had heard and seen as it was told them. That's the natural witness of the gospel. You and I are spiritually created to be witnessing naturally. We're to be in those places where we're weak. We're full of fear. We're trembling. We're to be in those places. And we wrestle in our inner man with our fears and the promises of God. And we trust God. And He delivers us. And it's a stark and astonishing deliverance. But it's impossible not to tell others about it. It's impossible. We just naturally, the distance between the natural and the supernatural is so gigantic that the natural man has to take a back seat, and it's no longer about me, it's about the Lord. It's about the testimony of the Lord. Now there's two other quick quips, and I'm fast running out of time. But we see that another door to providence is the door of faith. And here we see again, simple obedience. The law said, Mary and Joseph obeyed the law. They were righteous people. And they bring Jesus in the eighth day to be circumcised and to be purified. And the scripture speaks of two people that are there. Simeon. There was a man in Jerusalem named Simeon. The same man was just, devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel. The Holy Ghost was on him. That spirit man is alive. And it was revealed unto him by the Holy Ghost that he should not see death till he had seen the Lord's Christ. Now that's an unusual revelation, but in his circumstances, it was a personal and a private revelation. He was just waiting on the Lord. And so on this day, he didn't know when that would happen. He saw, and he came by the Spirit. Okay, that's really interesting too. He came by the Spirit into the temple. God had told him, the Spirit had told him he's going to see Jesus before he dies. And the Spirit prompts him to go into the temple. How did it prompt him? I have no idea. The Spirit prompted him. He learned, he knew how to walk in the Spirit. He walked, then the Spirit came to the temple. When the parents brought the child Jesus to do after him the custom of the law, took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, now you can let thy servant die. I heard that he was like 700 years old. I'm kidding. Let me die, Lord, I may finally see Jesus. So, and he gives this testimony of praise. And Joseph and Mary marvel at those things that Simon said. And he blessed them and says, behold, this child is set for rising and falling for many, and a sign which shall be spoken against. Isn't that interesting? Right at the very front end of it, a sign that shall be spoken against. The hatred against Christ always comes, always springs from the natural. And yea, a sword shall pierce thy own soul, that the thoughts of many hearts might be revealed. Did you get that phrase, that the thoughts of many hearts might be revealed? When you or I are in a difficult circumstance, we're called to walk by faith, we're called to walk in the Spirit, we're called to deny this life and cling to the promise of God and obedience and faith. And we're on stage. As soon as you're in that circumstance, you're on stage. And others are watching. And not only are others watching, you're going to have two groups watching you. Ones that hate you and despise you and speak ill of you, and all that you do will be evidence to them that you're insane and ridiculous. And those whose spirit is sensitive to heavenly things, and you'll lift them up and you'll encourage them. That's our job. That's our privilege. And then Anna, the prophetess. So my wife's name is Sarah. And so I really like that. That was a good name. So my first daughter was Sarah. But I always tried to name my children a biblical name. So if you come to Nancy Lorraine, you said, well, that's not a biblical name. So I just want you to understand, as a testimony, Nancy is a derivative of Anna. And my mother's name was Anna Lorraine, and Nana's name was Nancy Harlan, but Nancy's the derivative of Anna. So I chose Nancy for the Anna portion and Lorraine for my mother's. But I love this testimony. She was of a great age and had lived with her husband for 7 years after she got married. And she'd been a widow for 84 years. Do you know how many 84 years is, kids? What's a score? Anybody know what a score is? 20. So 84 is 4 20s. That's 80. So she had been married for 7 years, and now she had lived without a husband for 84 years. So she probably was 85 years old at least. But that would be assuming she got married at one, which she probably didn't. So she was nigh 100. I mean, it did say she was very old. But she comes in and fasting and praying. Now, it doesn't say that the Spirit of the Lord had told her, but here she was in her continual faithfulness. Just think of this. Now, okay, children, you don't understand this, okay? Coming from a little bit of a Catholic background, I understand it emotionally a little bit. But the temple of God was the house of God. God dwelt in that temple, and that was where you went to pray. The psalmist King David said, it's better to be in the house of God than anywhere else. So it was a precious place. So this dear lady, for 84 years, came to the temple every day, living a life of fasting and praying and service to the Lord, whatever she did in the temple. I have no idea all the other parts. 84 years faithfulness. And because of that faithfulness in her pursuit of God, she happened to be there at the right time when Jesus was there. And the Spirit quickened her as well. And she gave instant thanks and spoke of them to all that look for redemption in Israel. Close. You and I really need those horrible difficulties that we hate so much, that are so painful, that are so emotionally sometimes debilitating. We need them because that's the only way the Word of God can be preached clearly, accurately. I don't want to know the 5 steps that you took to raise perfect kids. First of all, I finished raising my kids. I don't have perfect kids, and I don't want to hear about it. I want to see Jesus at the place of my fear, at the place of my doubt, at the place of my need. I want to see him. And I'm sorry, when I'm walking in good success and it's plain that I'm doing it, I'm not really an encouragement to others. The clarity of the gospel needs to be me in my troubles, me in my trials, trusting God. And then God doing unusual things, things that are unexplainable. Things that we could say, this is only God. Only God could do this. So we have to treasure these things that have the smell of death to them. From the youngest age, children, until you're finally passing to the grave. Our life is built out of these expressions. The natural man doesn't have it, doesn't have the treasure, doesn't have the hope. How kind of God that he would so freely take possession of our natural lives and abuse them and knock us around so we wouldn't get caught up with having done good. I don't know anyone that doesn't try hard to do a good job with whatever they're doing. It's just kind of in our spirit. It's just the way we are. But it's never going to be our testimony. Our testimony is going to be the place where we were knocked about, where our weakness was all anybody could see, where somebody rolled their eyes and said, "Oh, brother, one of those, are you?" So that God chose the weak things. He chose the beggarly things. He chose the things that are despised in this world's eyes. And he chose all that so he could confound the mighty. I'm going to close with this little story. You know, it really feels good when God gets glory in your life. People see him instead of themselves. And how precious it is that we can live ourselves with such an abandon that that is what reaches across and touches the nerve. Every life. The point I wanted to make about all these stories, why did they keep spreading? The word would just spread abroad, and everybody would see something, and then they went out and told everybody. Just why? What was it like that? Because in every man's heart, there's this hunger for significance. It's a starving to really lay a hold of eternity. God has put eternity in our hearts, and we can't fathom it, but it's there. That little candle of significance is burning. And what you and I can do on the earth, try as we might, it's temporal. It's vanity. It's passing away. Somebody's going to do it again, and they'll probably do it better. But what God's doing, whatever God does, it lasts forever. And so we have one precious gift, the gift of life, and God says, you know what I want you to do? I want you to trust me with your temporal life so that even if your temporal life is thrown away, as men count it, you let me use it for eternal purposes so that I can count on it for my glory in eternity. That's our heritage. Let's pray. Let it be, Lord. We all have sorrows and difficulties. We all fear death so naturally. And yet, we so quickly forget that that place of our greatest fear is the doorway to the greatest revelation of you and your rescue and your purpose in Christ. So let it be, Lord, that like Paul said, I count it joy to have sorrows and to have trials and to have tribulations. For when I'm weak, then I'm strong. Lord, grant that our weakness might be the venue for our recovery, for our hope, and for our testimony. We ask in Christ's name. Amen.